tour is going to last between 30 and 40 minutes. It's a tour of the working factory. First of all, I'll tell you a little bit about the history of Foxtrot Woolen Mills. I'll explain a bit about production, and then we'll be walking into the factory. So, Foxtrot Woolen Mills was established in 1892 by an Irish nun called Sister Agnes Merle Burnage. Image of her here. She came to Foxtrot as a member of the Irish Sisters of Charity, and she wanted to create employment in the area. While she was here, she saw the River Moy was flowing outside the town, and this gave her the idea to build a woolen mill powered by the flowing waters of the river. She was helped by a man called John Smith, who ran the Caledon Woolen Mills in Northern Ireland. He came here to Foxtrot and he helped the Sisters of Charity to set up the business. By the start of the 20th century, Foxtrot Woolen Mills was employing 100 people here and had become a very successful business. All was going well in production until 1907, when unfortunately there was a fire here which destroyed all of the yarn store area in the factory. So all the wool, all the yarn, the supplies for weaving were completely destroyed in the blaze. But fortunately no one was killed or injured. They were able to rebuild the new yarn store and the factory went back into production. Foxtrot Woolen Mills went on to become even more successful after this, growing to a workforce of over 250 craftspeople. From the 1920s up until the 1980s, this large workforce was involved here. Unfortunately, in the 1980s, Ireland went through a difficult time of economic recession, which affected a lot of businesses here. In 1987, Foxtrot Woolen Mills went into receivership. So it had been owned by the Sisters of Charity all the way up to this point, but it was now in a lot of financial difficulty. It was really in danger of closing. Thankfully, it didn't close. It was taken over by a local man called Joe Queenan, who invested in the business, and he still owns it today. At the moment, we have a workforce of 70 people employed here. So about 30 would work in the factory production area. The rest of our staff would be in our shop, our cafe upstairs, and also our offices as well. Our factory here operates 5 days a week. So typical working hours would be Monday to Thursday, 8 until 5, and then Friday is 8 until 1. So we have a half day Friday. It's about 40 hours a week of production. All our woven items, so all our woven throws that we have here, the woven scarves, upholstery fabric, what you're sitting on, all of that is woven on site in our factory here. We use a variety of wool in our woven pieces. So we have lambswool, quite light and soft, we have merino, we have mohair, and we have cashmere as well. These would be sourced from a few different places. We would use some wool from Ireland, but we've also used wool from Australia and New Zealand. This is for a couple of reasons. First reason is, while we have a lot of sheep in Ireland, they're being raised for meat production first and foremost. So this often means the wool is a secondary product. We also have our climate to blame for the very coarse, very rough fleece that results in a lot of Irish sheep. So it's not as simple as getting a lovely soft merino sheep and bringing it to Ireland, but still the climate would greatly influence the outcome in product. So for this reason, we would use Irish wool. Where we can, we use wool, other wool, to get that really soft finish. A lot of Irish wool ends up in carpet making. So it's very strong, it's very durable, but it's kind of harder to get that more soft finish. The dyeing and spinning was done here in Foxtrot up until 30 years ago. So when the company went into receivership, that was removed from production. So we don't dye the wool or spin it here anymore. We get the wool that's been dyed and spun for us, but we do all of the designing, all the weaving, and all the finishing on site here today. All of our collections, they're designed by an Irish designer called Helen McAlinden. So she's been working with Foxford for the last 15 years or so. She comes up with new colours, new designs every year. The design process would be very important, so that would be the first stage really in production. Our designer, she would decide on different collar collections, what kind of fabric, what kind of wool is going to be used. So is it going to be something like this, very colourful, a spot design? In lambswool, is it going to be, this is merino? Different things like this all have to be decided before anything can be put into production. After a design has been finalised, it all has to be worked out mathematically on paper. So weaving is actually very, very technical. You have to work out how many threads of each collar and the correct sequence in order to get a certain design. So all of that is done here, and then it's sent to what's called the warping area of the factory. So weaving, in its basic sense, like your traditional basket weaving, it's composed of two sets of threads. So the warp are on the vertical threads, the weft are the ones going horizontally and going across. So the first stage in production, as I said, is the design process, but after the design has been finalised, the next stage is called the warping process. So I'll be showing you a short video of this. The warping process refers to getting all the vertical threads, which are the warp, getting the correct number, the correct colours, putting them onto a large metal beam before they can be taken in here where they'll be translated into woven fabric. So I will just show you now this video and I'll talk you through it as well. This happens upstairs in our factory. So the first stage in the warping process is called creeling. So this is where each spool of thread has to be selected and put in the right order. And a thread has to be taken from each spool. They're all counted, they're all put in the correct sequence, and they're all following what's called the design table. So it's got all the details, it's like a pattern. This particular video here refers to the mohair yarn, so that's like a loop soft yarn. It's about 500 threads going across there. Here he's threading the reed, so he's putting each one in individually through the reed, which is like a large metal comb. Essentially what he's doing there is taking each thread individually, making sure they're in the correct order and that nothing is crossing over. It's quite a technical, tedious kind of process. It takes a lot of concentration and it has to be done correctly. Once all the threads are in order, the next process is called running the swift. So this is where they're all run to a length of about 70 meters. So it makes sure they're all the same length, each thread is the same length, same tension, and before they're all wound onto what's called the weaver's beam.
Taken downstairs, it's brought in here, which is called a weaving shed. It's
So this is where it will be secured onto the back of the machine, or the loom as it's called. It's secured onto this, and then each individual thread has to be put through the machine by hand. So they all have to be threaded individually through, they're called pedals. They're essentially like needles which lift up and down in the loom process. The threading process can take a lot of time. It's completely manual, so it usually takes two people about 4 hours to thread one machine. It really can vary depending on the amount of threads that you have. So a mohair blanket will have about 500 threads going across it. The lamb's wool is much finer and lighter. You have about 1,500. The maximum amount of threads would be 2,500 that have to go through them initially. So as you can imagine, it's a lot of concentration, a lot of patience, and if they make a mistake, they have to start all over again. So it's really, really something you have to have your head screwed on for. After the machines are threaded, then we can set up what's called a weft insertion, which is the threads going horizontally. That can be set up to be reasonably automated. It's not all done by hand, but the machines all have to be looked after in case anything goes wrong in production. For example, if the thread breaks, which happens from time to time, the machine will just shut off and stop automatically. One of our workers then will have to come along, find the broken thread, tie what's called a beaver's knot, so tie either end together in a very small but very firm knot, and then production can start up again after this. Usually about after 2 days, a roll of fabric is completed. A roll will contain about 40 of these, so there'll be 40 of the same pattern, maybe the gap between each for cutting at a later stage. Okay, so does anyone have any questions? It's a lot of information to take in.